I grew up playing on an 8-bit console. The NES. Back then, it was all about the games. Now, years later, thanks to Ben Eater's amazing series on the SAP-1 and the 6502, I finally understand how all that stuff actually worked. I felt ready to create my own build. So I decided to build my own 8-bit computer. I'm not building an NES, far from it. My goal is to build a computer from scratch while learning how it works. With real wires, real chips, and real solder. Maybe with a little help from an emulator, I plan to write along the way. And honestly, this is as much fun as playing DuckTales. I'm building this machine module by module, fully soldered, and entirely custom. For now, I'm using the 6502. But in the future, I plan to build my own processor module, inspired by Ben Eater's SAP-1 series. And hey, if you decide to follow along, I'll be truly honored to have you join me on this journey. This video is the intro and overview of the series. Some of the modules are already built, and some I'll be building as we go. Just to be clear, I'm not an expert. I'm figuring this out as I go, learning from mistakes, and trying to understand how these systems really work. This whole project is a way for me to learn by doing. And if you're into that kind of thing, you're in the right place. Maybe you've built something like this yourself, or you're planning to. For me, the next step was sharing it, so I decided to capture it all on video. Now there's something I really need to say. A huge shout out to Ben Eater. His SAP 1 and 6502 series are what pulled me into this rabbit hole. If you don't know him, he's basically the Bob Ross of retro computing. His explanations are crystal clear, his style is incredibly approachable, and somehow he makes you believe you can build an entire 8-bit computer with just some jumper wires, and suddenly, you're doing it. In my day job, I'm a programmer, but building a computer from scratch has taught me things I never learned from writing code. Back to my project. Like most people, I started out with breadboards, but cheap ones gave me unreliable connections, voltage drops, and a lot of frustration. For example, in this clip, I measured the voltage on the exact same circuit, first on a breadboard, then on a soldered version, by probing the pins of a specific logic chip. And honestly, soldering is just more fun. Of course, I still prototype each module on a breadboard first, but once it works, I recreate the schematic in KCAD, then move everything onto a custom PCB and solder it up. For this project, I'm using custom PCBs with the symbol UM10W, made by a local manufacturer. It has 5 rows for placing ICs or connector sockets, and built-in power traces, which perfectly match the pin spacing of most 74 series logic chips. These boards aren't laid out exactly like a breadboard. Instead of 5 rows on each side, you get 3 on one and 4 on the other. But honestly, that's been plenty for everything I've built so far. And that's not an ad, more like a helpful clue if you're looking for something similar. One of the biggest design challenges I faced early on was figuring out how to connect all the modules together. With so many address and data lines, routing everything reliably was tough. At first, I even tried soldering a custom backplane on a PCB using IDC16 connectors, but that felt too limiting. Then it hit me. The bus doesn't have to be on a PCB. I could use a ribbon cable. So I repurposed the familiar IDC40 connector and designed a complete layout. That's how SEBA1 was born. Short, extensible, bus architecture. SEBA1 uses a 40-pin IDC ribbon cable, 24 address lines, 8 data lines, 4 control signals, and 4 spare pins for future upgrades. If this sounds like overkill, maybe it is. But it gives me up to 16 megabytes of addressable space, and that opens up a ton of possibilities. It's flexible, modular, and reliable. Mounting IDC40 connectors onto my PCBs wasn't straightforward. I added a small in-between board to adjust the pin spacing and save space on the main PCB. Now about the architecture. One of the main boards will host the processor, either the SAP-style CPU I'll design later, or Ben Eater's 65C02 setup with RAM and ROM. All the other boards will act as peripherals, which I'll address directly and use to perform various operations. For example, one of the first modules will be the 65C22 versatile interface adapter. In Ben's project, it handles communication through two parallel ports, and I'll be using it in a similar way in my system. Each module needs to respond to a specific address range on the bus, and to make that work, I plan to include an address comparator on most of the boards. The logic comparator simply checks the current address on the bus and activates the module only if it matches a predefined value. Here comes the chip jargon. I'll most likely use the 74LS684 for 8-bit comparison, or the 74ALS677 for 16-bit ranges, depending on how much address space each module needs. I'm powering each board separately. No shared power through the bus. I made a simple power rail for that, and I'm running it from a linear power supply to keep things nice and stable. I'm planning to build everything. Memory modules, some retro-style storage like hard drives, video output using 6845 CRT controller and dual-port static RAM, sound using AY38910, and eventually that SAP-inspired CPU. This series is my twist on that journey, with solder, custom PCBs, and way too many wires. If you want to see where this goes, hit subscribe, because in the next episode, I'll show you the first working module, the Seba One Bus Debugger. The journey's just getting started. See you in the next episode.